What's going on, guys? It's OmniArk, and today I'm bringing you a brand new video where we're going to be going over the latest patch update coming soon to Rise of Kingdoms. Alright, so this is a really big update, so just bear with me. We're going to go through all of the patch notes here in case you guys haven't taken a deep dive into it. I'll give you my thoughts and opinions on the changes that are coming to Rise of Kingdoms. And also, I want to talk about the AoE change, the AoE nerf that was discussed about a week or two ago when I wasn't uploading videos. But I'll talk about that near the end of the video because I'm sure all of you guys have already heard about that and you already have your opinions. So the next update to Rise of Kingdoms is 1.0.4 Dance of Chaos. This is coming to the game on November 18th. So we're about 5 days away at the time of recording this. And this is, to my knowledge, the biggest crossover between Rise of Kingdoms and any other video game franchise out there. Dynasty Warriors 9 is going to have a crossover event coming soon to this game. And it says a legendary dancer, a godlike warrior, and a plot which plunged all of China into chaos. A limited time Dynasty Warriors 9 crossover event will begin soon. Rock Governors will be able to recruit Dynasty Warriors 9 characters Lu Bu and Dio-chan. I don't know, I'm not familiar with Dynasty Warriors at all. Obviously, I've heard of the franchise, but I've never really played any of the games, so I don't know who these characters are. I know a lot of people are familiar with them, so I imagine they are pretty prominent characters in the franchise and the games. Now, this morning over on Twitter, the official Rise of Kingdoms Twitter account posted this image, so we do have confirmation of the new characters and what they are going to look like in the game. Let's jump back over to the patch notes and we can take a look at what they say. So apparently the event is going to be called Dance of Friendship, complete quests to earn great rewards, including a chance to get the epic commander Dio-chan for free. So one of these commanders is going to be epic. I think this is really good. And as I've talked about many times before on this channel, we need more epic commanders in this game. We need better epic commanders in this game because as time progresses, the legendaries are getting stronger and stronger and stronger, and we're left with the same epics, roughly speaking, as the beginning of the game. So I'm glad it's an epic. I'm hoping it's not a gathering commander like all the other epics, or like the previous epic Matilda was. And secondly, the intriguing dancer and powerful demon god bundles are available for a limited time buy them to get the new commanders Dio-chan and Lu Bu. So apparently you could just straight up buy these commanders. I don't know if this is going to give you like items that you can exchange during that event, or if you'll just straight up get like sculptures of them for these purchases. That's going to be interesting to see. I think if Dio-chan is the epic, then Lu Bu is going to be the legendary, I assume, unless they're both epic. I don't actually know, but if that is the case, this is going to be really interesting to see. If Lu Bu is really powerful, then this is kind of a pay to win thing, which we'll just have to wait and see. I don't want to jump the gun, but that could be the case. It depends on how expensive the bundle is. Now, it's also worth noting that the event says that you can actually get Dio-chan for free, but there's not a way, according to this, to get the Lu Bu for free. So it may be the case that you have to buy that legendary if you want, which I'll probably do. Maybe I'll just unlock them, I don't know. But this is exciting, right? This is, regardless of how these commanders are introduced into the game, this is exciting because, like I said, this is the biggest crossover that we've seen in Rise of Kingdoms, and that hopefully that opens the door for even more epic crossovers in the future. Plus, this is going to probably bring in a lot of players from the Dynasty Warriors franchise, which is always exciting. It's always good to get a fresh set of new players into the game. The next big change comes to the Lost Kingdom. It says, some Lost Kingdom rewards have been adjusted in order to help governors craft better equipment. We've added more equipment related rewards and reduced the number of speed ups while preserving the overall value of each reward tier. At the same time, we've changed some of the Crusader achievements progress requirements. These changes will take effect during the next Lost Kingdom season and will not affect any seasons currently in progress. So this is good, right? I think equipment is kind of the direction that the game has been focused on for the last 6 months or more, which is really nice to see. I know a lot of players speed ups, like if you're at the end game, like you're really just going to turn those into troops, which is fine, but I think a lot of players would rather equipment, which is awesome. We've discovered that in some older kingdoms, power increases come primarily from training troops, but that the growth potential for the power of each troop is actually quite hindered by troop capacity limits. With this in mind, we've optimized the Lost Kingdom matchmaking rules. Now governors with a power higher than 150 million will be calculated as 150 million for matchmaking purposes. This change will also be applied for calculating power for Imperium kingdoms. This is huge. This is actually a massive deal for Imperiums, right? This makes sense, okay? This makes sense. If you are a 150 million power player versus a 300 million power player, the odds are that you both have a ton of really powerful legendaries, really powerful equipment. The only difference between the two is the number of troops that you have. And because you can only have an army with 200,000 or 210,000 troops at a time, or 300,000, whatever, this just makes sense, right? 150 million power player and a 300 million power player could be roughly the same power in terms of effectiveness in a war. And so the 300 million power player shouldn't be counted twice as heavily, because they're not nearly twice as effective. And in fact, they're almost equally as effective. The 300 million power player could just fight for longer. But even at 150 mil, you can fight for hours and hours and hours, and then just spend to build it back up. So this is really good. This is a really good change. I would almost argue that 150 million is too high. You could probably change this to like 120 million and it would, and I think that would be a little bit better, but, this is still a huge milestone and good progress. Especially for calculating Imperium, I think this is very valuable. The third point is added Bumper Harvest, a limited time Lost Kingdom super value resource bundle. So this is good. We already have the resource reserves bundle here in the shop. And I do know that there are some big spenders that do like to purchase resource reserves during KVK because they just need the reserves to, or the resources to heal their troops. But this is like historically just not a very good bundle in terms of value. It's just not, right? I mean, really, you're buying this for the gold, and that's pretty much it when you're T5. Maybe some other things as well, but it's nice to know that it sounds like they're gonna be adding a new bundle that's only available during KVK, and hopefully that bundle will really focus more on the T5 player who really only needs that the gold, right? They really just need the gold. That's the biggest thing. So we'll have to wait and see what that bundle looks like and if it's actually valuable or not. They also have made changes to Heroic Anthem, the latest version of KVK. This is really good. This means that they have been testing since the launch of Heroic Anthem, and they've already started making changes, which is really good. So they've optimized the model, models for Crystal Mines, Crystal Research Centers, and Bastions to make them more aesthetically pleasing. I like that. We love aesthetically pleasing. Optimize the names of some Crystal Research Center technologies to make them easier to understand. That's good. Optimize the Coalition Honor Points and Camp Honor Points icons to make them more aesthetically pleasing. Sure, this is fine. They've changed some language things and optimized the logic of support skills. Support skills will now work normally regardless of which commander troop setup has them equipped, but commanders still cannot equip their own skills as support skills. That's good. These are all good changes, mostly just cosmetic. Golden Kingdom event optimization. We discovered that the Golden Kingdom is too hard for some governors and have made the following adjustments to address that. They adjusted the event difficulty to be more reasonable. Guardian's power will now scale with the length of a kingdom's history. That's an interesting way to tackle this event. I really like that. This doesn't help if you're a new player in an old kingdom, but regardless, adjusted how Healer's Hut healing works. Now the Healer's Hut will restore a set amount for all troops. Interesting. So previously the Healer Hut would just restore one army of your choosing's capacity by 50% of its maximum. So if you didn't have an army that was at 50% or lower, you kind of were losing value on the Healer's Hut. The fact that it now sounds like it'll just do a small amount to all troops, I don't know if that's better or worse, but I imagine that they've calculated it and worked it out to make it better, which is good. Adjusted the prices of some relics to be more reasonable. This is good. I've always thought that the relics pricing was really weird. I was always left with like 100 or 200 relics, and I just could never really get the full value out of them. Some of the more expensive ones didn't seem that valuable. Like the major healing ones weren't nearly as valuable as ones that you could teleport guardians to different spots, because then you could just avoid a battle altogether, at least in my opinion. And then optimize the screen for reinforcement camps while summoning troops. You can now tap on a troop's portrait to see a breakdown of its unit type. That's cool. It's good to know that information. This is a huge update, by the way, guys. That's why this video is going to be so long. Commander skill optimizations and bug fixes. Fix an error in the description for Harald Sigurdsson's passive skill, Varangian Guard. Varangian Guard? I have no idea. The description originally stated that the defense loss, which each level scaled as follows, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. In fact, the defense penalty at every level is always 5%, and after the update, the description should match the actual effects. I guess that makes sense. I don't know how they could have messed this up, right? But regardless, fix an error in the description for Zenobia's expertise skill, Ascending Augusta. The description originally stated that the troops healed by this skill gained 50% increased health for 2 seconds. In fact, the actual effect should read, troops healed by this skill gain 50% increased health and 30% increased damage for 2 seconds. After the update, the description should match the actual effects. So here's the thing. It seemed to be the case that Zenobia's expertise was really powerful when it was first unlocked by people, right? When people first started expertising her, they realized, wow, this expertise is actually really good. And so I think that people already assumed that there was something else going on there. This to me though, feels like they intentionally left this out. Like that's a huge thing to mess up, right? Like 30% increased damage, that's wild. For 2 seconds, that's crazy. So I don't know how they could possibly have messed up this description. I really don't understand that. Number three says, adjusted the effects of Artemisia's active skill Battle of Salamis. The skill will deal damage to all troops led by this commander, damage factor 300. Before the fix, this skill could severely wound your own units, but after the fix, it will only be able to slightly wound them. So that's really interesting. I actually think that this is good, right? Unless you have some sort of healing with Artemisia, right? Because now if you're going to be getting more slightly wounded, that means you'll have a bigger pool to draw your healing from. So healing effects are probably going to be enhanced by this, which will still ultimately lead to more sev wounds and more deads if you're defending a flag. So I actually don't know what I feel about this. I don't really understand her skill enough to say for certain this is good or bad. It's probably good though. This is probably a slight buff or a decent buff to Artemisia if I were to guess, but I don't really have enough experience with her to say for certain like, oh, she's broken now. This is probably just a small change that's just better for people who have her expertise. All right, immigration system optimizations. In order to prevent any serious power imbalances during the early stages of a kingdom's existence, we've made the following adjustments to the immigration rules. Optimized the kingdom list page. Governors can now see more concise descriptions of immigration rules to each kingdom status, and each kingdom status. That's great. Transparency is always good. It's better to understand things. When all kingdoms on a single continent are between the nascent and developed phases, the continent will have two rising kingdoms, counting only the top 300 governors in each kingdom's power rankings, and the two kingdoms with the highest total power will be the rising kingdoms. Governors with 10 million or more power will not be able to immigrate to rising kingdoms, but rising kingdom status will change in real time with shifts in the total power ranking. If a kingdom is both a rising kingdom and an imperium kingdom, rising kingdom immigration rules shall prevail. This is interesting. If you are an Imperium and your kingdom is that young, then holy Jesus, that's insane. Overall, this is good. I think that this just gives more transparency as to which kingdoms are the most powerful, and it kind of prevents them from getting too powerful too early on, which I think is good. The more balancing kingdoms, the better that KVK will be, and I think the better KVK will be, the more people will be engaged in the game and have more fun. Optimize the logic for immigration on the same continent. Governors are now allowed to immigrate to an older kingdom on the same continent, even if the target kingdom is not developed yet. This is interesting. I guess this kind of goes hand in hand with the previous bullet point where they're trying to balance out the power. And so one way to do that is to just allow, make it a little bit easier to travel between multiple kingdoms in that continent. So that's really good. Other optimizations, optimized rallies. Governors can now choose to leave rallies at any time. Lilith, this is amazing. This is incredible. I'm so happy for this. And the reason that this is good is because if a player rallies a target and the rally is going and that target is suddenly a target that you no longer want to rally, and the player who leads the rally is not paying attention or they're offline or something like that, or if you have an army in that rally and you need to bring it back to your city so you can teleport somewhere else, now you can leave rallies at any time. And that's really good. I don't know why it took so long for this to be a thing. But this is a huge improvement. I absolutely love this. And there's been so many times in the past where I've been stuck in rallies that I know I'm just going to be taking massive deads for no reason, which of course is my own fault for joining that rally. But now I have a way to get out of that situation instead of just getting punished the entire time. So that's good. Added a counter showing how many alliance members are online. It's helpful when alliance leaders and officers try to arrange some events. So this is good. They don't have to go through and actually count who's online, right? They can just see, okay, we have 40 people online, whatever. They also added 4 limited edition 7-day supplies, 1 each for food, wood, stone, and gold. Each of these will be available on rotation in your kingdom for a limited time. Purchase limit 2 per resource type. So this is going to be interesting. They already have 7-day supplies for these, but it's I'm hoping that these are actually going to be worth purchasing, because as it stands, they're not. Osiris League Grand Finals are starting. We already knew this. Reduce the level requirement for equipping the Forest Guardian set. Now commanders only need to reach level 30 to equip it. honestly, I didn't even know that you needed a level minimum to use that set. So cool. Added 4 new accessories. So we have the Kurok's War Drum, Seth's Call, Wind Scars, and Ancient Stratagems. This is interesting. It's gonna, like, this is good depending on how hard they are to get. If they're difficult to get, then I don't care about this. The accessories are already too hard to get in the game, so there's that. But if these are relatively easy to get, then cool. I think that's good for the game. Reduce the amount of gold required to forge normal and advanced equipment. That's good. This is good for free-to-play players. This is good for people who are trying to just get the special talent on some, like, grays and greens, which is really awesome. So that's good. Add in an alliance application sorting feature. The alliance leader and the officers can now sort applications by time applied, power, or number of kills. This is incredibly good for those alliance leaders. For everyone else, I guess this doesn't really change too much. Optimize the expedition system. Now, when you exit an expedition, your troop arrangements will be saved. If your troop capacity or total units changes while you're away from the expedition, the system will automatically update. This is really good. I wish that they had this back when I was still going through expedition, because there would be times where I'd be testing things and then I'd be like, okay, well, I should actually change my city skin, and then I would go and change and come back, and then I got to reconfigure all the armies, and it is what it is. So this is really good. I'm glad they did that, but it doesn't affect end game players. After entering the battlefield in the Swirly Crisis event, you will be able to change roles before the battle starts. At the same time, we have optimized the enmity list display for clarity. So it sounds like once you teleport into Swirly Crisis and you realize, okay, we actually need another tank, you can change to tank before anyone starts attacking any of the enemies. So that's really good. I think that this will help balance out the matchmaking when you just random queue and you end up with 4 tanks and 1 DPS, or, you know what I mean? So that's good. Adjusted the price of Kingdom newspapers to 1,000 golds. I don't know. I don't really care about this. The newspapers, whatever. Resolve some screen lag issues, including those caused by having large numbers of troops on screen at the same time. Thank you, Lilith. Thank you. We've been asking for lag fixes for ages. It's nice to see that they know that and that this should be a priority. So the fact that this is the last bullet point on the list is shocking to me. They should have put this first, like, hey guys, we're working on lag. Like, that's good. The fact that it's the last bullet point makes me think, like, maybe this is not a huge change. It's just a very slight upgrade and we're not even going to notice it, but fingers crossed that this does help the lag issue a lot. All right, now let's talk about the change to AoE skills here. This has been discussed at length by other Rise of Kingdoms content creators, but I figured maybe some of you guys actually want to know what my opinion is on this change. So if you guys haven't seen this before, this is what it says. This is in the developer update that's posted on the official discussion board inside the game. It says, my troops just stood near the city and didn't join the attack, but when the garrison commander used their AoE skills, my troops got killed. Why? Before even reading this, I can tell you why. But regardless, when commanders leading the garrison of the city or stronghold use our AoE, the skills will also damage those nearby enemies who are not attacking the city or stronghold. We found that not a few players had no idea of this mechanism and got their troops killed in this way. So we're planning to make the following adjustments. Troops that are not attacking the city or stronghold will be severely wounded instead of dying from AoE skills of garrison commanders. So if you guys didn't know, this is actually how it's always worked for rallies. So for example, if you rallied with, like, a Ramses Isong A, and your Isong did his AoE attack and there was defenders standing nearby, those defenders would get severely wounded, whereas prior to this change, if you had an Isong in the flag and you were defending and that Isong used its AoE and the attackers were near the flag, they would get deads. And so it was different, and the reason that it's different is because of the way that the game fundamentally calculates attacker versus defender. If you are defending a flag, you take 50% deads. If you are attacking a flag, you take 100% deads. So there's just a fundamental difference in how attackers and defenders are calculated. And the reason that the game works this way, and the reason that I'm glad that the game works this way, is because it deters people from just going through and attacking everybody's city and only losing half their troops. So if you decide to attack, there's a steep consequence for doing so, in that you lose 100% of your troops. Now, the reason that people were confused is because they weren't in the rally, so they were just standing nearby, but they were still taking deads. And the reason for that is because they are part of the attacking alliance, right? That AoE skill goes off, and anybody that's in the alliance or alliances that are attacking that flag would take those deads, right? And I think that the game should probably work that way. I think the argument that, oh, players didn't know that this was a mechanic, is a terrible argument, because once it happens the first time, you're like, oh, okay, since I'm part of the attackers, I take full deads. Better be careful, right? That's like the only conclusion that you could possibly come to, unless you're just a terrible player, in which case, if you are, you're gonna eventually learn the hard way. However, if this update is good or not depends on your opinion on the balance of attacking versus defending. We've seen Attila Takeda dominating the game for a very long time now because it's a very powerful rallying combo. We've also seen a lot of new defensive commanders come into the game that are also really, really powerful. So it depends on whether you think that the garrison commanders are stronger than the rallying commanders in the game at this time. If you think that the defending commanders in this game are more powerful and harder to crack a defense than it is to lead a successful rally, this is good because this is effectively a nerf to the defender, right? Now the defenders are not getting that full value out of their AoE skills. Sure, it's still severely wounding, but it's not killing. And so there's a decrease in the value that you get from each AoE attack that goes off. And because of that, this is also buffing the attackers. So if you're in an instance where the enemy team is just rallying you like crazy and you just have no way to stop them, well, now they're slightly more powerful because they're not going to be taking deads from from reinforcing that rally and just being nearby that rally. Honestly, I don't like this change for the simple reason that it changes the game logic. Like, the game logic is literally defenders take half deads, or a half sev wounds and half deads, and the attackers take full deads. I think that that should just be consistent throughout the game. If you didn't know that, now you know. The fact that they're changing it, it just makes it more confusing, because now what if they release something more powerful than Attila Takeda? Now the attackers also have that plus this advantage, and it's gonna happen, right? Eventually there's gonna be something more powerful than Attila Takeda. Of course, right? We all know this is going to come at some point. So personally, I don't see a reason to change this. I don't think this is a big deal. If this is just a matter of understanding the game, right? But it is what it is. I would love to hear your comments in the comment section below. With that being said, guys, if you made it all the way to the end of this video, I would really appreciate you dropping a thumbs up on it. It really does help out the channel a ton. If you're new around here, subscribe to the channel and click that bell to be notified the next time that I upload a Rise of Kingdoms video. As always, my social media links are in the description below. So make sure you follow me over there on Instagram, Twitter, Discord, and Twitch. And finally, if you want, there's a link in the description below to download Rise of Kingdoms absolutely for free. It's a program called Blue Stocks. It's what I'm using right now, which is why you can see my cursor. It's my favorite way to play Rise of Kingdoms, and I experience fewer crashes than if I were to play this on like an older phone. And like I said, it's absolutely free, so make sure you go ahead and click that link in the description below and give it a try. With that being said, guys, thank you so much for watching. This has been Omniarch. I will talk to you guys again soon. Peace.